Hi, it's Tom. How are you today? So, today's video is going to be about gesture drawing. And we'll do maybe a gesture drawing or two together. I'll show you some examples of gesture drawings that I've done in the past. And I'll share with you some tips and observations from my short time of gesture drawing. And if you're advanced, or even if you're a beginner, and you want to share some of your tips and observations with myself and the rest of us, feel free, please, in the comments below. It's always very helpful to get different perspectives and see what other people's experiences are like. And that's how we learn, right? All right, so without any further wait, let's begin. So, what is gesture drawing? According to the textbook that I learned it from, The Natural Way to Draw, by Kimon, Nicolaides?
Kimon, Nicolaides.
We'll define gesture drawing as not what a thing looks like and not what it is, but what your subject is doing, what the action is, what the movement is. So we're going to be drawing the movement and not the object. If someone, say a pitcher, is throwing a baseball, we're not drawing a man, we're not drawing the pitcher himself, we are drawing the throw of the ball, the way the movement feels to us. We are, in a way, reacting, we're drawing our reaction to the action of the subject, and we're trying to convey the feeling of the movement. And obviously, this is a very intangible quality that you're trying to capture, and there are many ways to do this, and there's no right or wrong way, so whatever way feels good to you, all the better. These aren't going to be finished masterpieces that we're doing. These are going to be exercises in becoming more comfortable with interpreting intangible information that is involved in expressing a movement. That's probably the most difficult way I could say that, but that's what it is. Okay, so obviously I'm going to show you some of my gesture drawings, but they're really not drawn to be seen so much. These are drawn for your own benefit to create a layer of understanding of movement that you can hopefully further apply to your art studies and to your drawings or whatever art form you choose to do in the future. You'll be able to put down a layer of movement, and that along with other layers of, say, weight and contour and cross contour, light and shadow, all of these things combined are what hopefully make successful pictures, or pictures that bring yourself and maybe even the people you show them to a good feeling, an appreciation, I guess you could say. So, moving on. So some people will approach gesture drawing with very clean lines and with a very minimal amount of lines. They'll want to extract from the subject which lines, we'll call them lines of action, are going to best portray the movement of the subject. So if a boxer is throwing a punch, we are going to find which line of action is the focal point of that movement. Is it the twist of the boxer's hips? Is it the throw of his shoulder? Is it his arm extended? Is it the foot that he is pushing off of to throw the punch? I guess it depends on the subject, right? So these are things to think about. The style that is taught in the textbook that I learned this from encourages more of a scribbling approach, but feel free to do any style you like. So you're going to look at the subject. We'll pick, just for our video today, we'll use a tennis match. Now you can see here I've just typed in tennis match into the YouTube search engine, and I got this most epic tennis match in the world. All right, so let's draw the most epic tennis gesture that we can. No, I'm just kidding. It's not going to be very epic, but it's going to be a gesture nonetheless. So I've got the screen paused right here. So we'll take a second before we begin, and let's set ourselves a time limit, okay? Let's give ourselves 15 seconds for each gesture drawing, okay? Now, you can give yourself as much time as you like, obviously, but for the sake of this video, we'll take 15 seconds, and we'll just do a few 15-second gesture drawings of the two tennis players here that we see on the screen, okay? So you're going to keep your eyes on the screen and just let your hand flow, okay? So I'm going to be using this scribbling approach. I'm going to be looking at the subject. It's up to you whether you want to keep a continuous gaze on the subject or if you want to look down at your paper off and on. That's up to you. But I'm just going to be looking at the screen, at the thing that I'm drawing, and I'm not going to let my pencil leave the paper. And I'm kind of just going to feel my way through the movement. It's not going to look it's not going to look awesome. You know, it's not going to look super impressive, but what I'm doing is I'm trying to learn how the movement of the subject feels to me. And that's what you're going to want to do, to learn how it feels to you. And how are you expressing it? Doesn't have to look like anything special, but in time, it will at least feel like something special when you're doing it. Okay? All right. So, let's begin. Okay. So, let's get started. The things that we'll need are something to draw with, pen or a pencil or a marker or whatever you have, and some paper. Scrap paper's fine because, like we said, these aren't going to be masterpieces. These are just exercises. Okay, so no pressure. I'm going to be using a number 2 pencil just because that's what I have. And like I said before, I'm going to be using this scribble technique, but feel free to do whatever kind of technique you like. There is no right way and no wrong way. All right, so I've set aside 3 frames in sequence of a tennis player serving a tennis ball. We're going to watch the video of the tennis player serving a few times in regular speed. We'll watch it a couple times in slow motion, and then we will pick out the individual frames that we are going to be gesture drawing, and we'll just break down very quickly some observations on what's happening, and then we will draw. So here we go. Okay, so the first frame that we're going to draw is this one right here. We see that the tennis player about to serve is crouching down. He's driving his weight into his dominant leg, into his foot, into the ground. Something to keep in mind in terms of how this feels to us. He's pressing into the ground while simultaneously throwing his arm upward. So most of his weight is on his dominant leg here. Like he's pressing down on a spring, is extending upward in the opposite direction. And we are catching him in that split second right before he springs back up. And his dominant arm, with his racket, is there ready to swing. Okay, here's the second frame we're going to draw. We're catching him right after that powerful serve. His dominant arm that's holding the racket has thrust him forward. His left leg is already being pulled down by gravity and also the power of his downward serve. His other leg is kicking out as a counterbalance, but we see it's almost like an S or a backwards S. Again, that's what it feels like to me. You make your own observations on what this movement feels like to you. All right, so our last frame. He's already served, and the other tennis player has returned his serve, and he's just realized that it's going to this side of the court, and he's shifting his weight from his right leg onto his left leg to sidestep over to the side of the court to be ready to return that ball. That weight transfer is what I'm seeing. And that weight transfer is the thing that I feel most from this frame. Okay, are you ready? I think I'm ready. Let's give ourselves 30 seconds for this gesture, okay? So 30 seconds on the clock. I'll tell you when the time's up. But if you finish early or later, doesn't really matter. But I'll let you know when about 30 seconds is up. All right, so let's begin. Go. All right, and time's about up. How'd you do? Let's move on to our next one, okay? Let's take 30 seconds for this one as well. And whenever you're ready, let's start. All right, that's about 30 seconds. Let's move on to our last one. Let's do two gestures for the last one. Let's make them each about 15 seconds this time. See if we can really capture the feeling that's being expressed by the movement of this subject, by this tennis player. Feel free to just be loose with it. Don't be thinking about the final product. Don't be thinking about what it's going to look like at the end. It doesn't really matter. The goal here is to just capture the feeling inside of your mind, okay? So we'll do two gesture drawings of the third frame here, 15 seconds each. Let's begin. Okay, the time is up. Let's get right into our next one. Okay, time's up. Good job. So now that we've done this first gesture drawing, let's take a second and just think about what was happening in our own minds while we were drawing here. Obviously, we're looking at a subject, but we're not copying the subject. We're not doing a contour drawing. We're not finding necessarily its outline or its shape. So we want to try to put ourselves into the shoes, so to speak, of the subject. We're using our imagination to project ourselves into our subject so we can better express what the feeling of movement is that's happening. Using the tennis player as an example, what would it feel like to do this tennis serve? We're trying to feel what he is feeling so we can express his movement. The power of visualization. While you were drawing, or maybe before you were getting ready to draw this gesture, were you visualizing yourself as the tennis player? Imagining what it felt like to crouch down, to throw that ball into the air, to be poised, ready to leap into the air, to swing the racket. Visualizing is obviously a huge part of art, without which you'll just always be looking for a line to copy. And I feel like that's what I was stuck in, or most geared toward, when I first started drawing. Looking for lines and outlines and drawing them, and that's great, you know, that's a huge component of drawing. But there's more to it. If you look at masters, if you look at people who really grasp the fundamentals of artistic expression, if you look at whatever artist you admire, there's an intangible quality about the art that draws you in and makes you feel like you're a part of the painting. Sometimes we look at artwork and we feel like it invites us in. What is that feeling that invites us in? It's the power of visualization. The artist has put himself into the subject already, and we take on the role of the artist when we view. Do you see what I mean? Is that a little too far out there? Maybe it is. So in my own experience, I got really into exercise earlier in my life, into strength training. I learned a lot about the power of visualization through exercise, through weight training. Most importantly, through compound movements like deadlifting and squatting, etc., etc. So I feel like that was a skill that I was able to take from one realm that seemed unrelated and bring into this new endeavor of learning how to draw. It's pretty cool because if you have learned how to do anything before, and we've all learned how to do something, right? We can take the platform, or we can take the framework that we used to learn whatever it is that you're already good at. If you take time to analyze what allowed you to get good at the things that you're already good at, and then apply that same mentality or that same framework to the acquisition of a new skill, in this case, or drawing, you'll find that you really only need to learn how to do one thing in order to learn how to do many things. And in my opinion, at least, the greatest thing that you can learn is learn how to make yourself fascinated by small things. So we're looking at this tennis player, and we could look at it, and I could look at it right now, and I could say, well, yeah, pretty cool serve, but it's kind of boring, right? It's just some man jumping up and down and hitting a ball. And that's one way to look at it. But if you can teach yourself to look at it and be fascinated by the movement, and to slow it down and to understand it in a way that only you can. We're learning not so much in an academic sense. Sure, the academic parts of art are important as well. But learning how to interpret information and learning how to be curious about your own interpretation of the information, that's the key to keeping yourself interested. And keeping yourself interesting. If you can apply a level of curiosity or fascination to even the most mundane things, such as this man jumping and swinging a tennis racket, if you can find a way to get excited about that, even just within the realm of gesture drawing, you're going to find that it's a lot easier to make the progress that you desire. And the progress is going to come a lot more quickly because being curious about something and being fascinated by something, it heightens your awareness. So this man is only jumping, but when we stop and we break down his movements and we see exactly what's going on, and like we said, it's not just from an academic standpoint, not just from the scientific explanation of the kinetics of his movement, it's about your own interpretation of it in a way that only you can interpret it. So that's a lot of far out talk, right? For a couple scribbles on a page. But the important thing that we're getting from this exercise is not the scribbles. It's not the drawing itself. It's what was happening in your mind when you were drawing it. Where were you? What were you thinking about? What was the feeling that you were conveying through the scribbles or through the strokes of your pencil? All right? Something to think about. And I think that's enough talking. I think I went off on a little bit of a tangent. So let's wrap it up. I have a few more examples of gesture drawings that I'll show you here, and that's about it. So thanks for watching, and happy drawing. Have a great day. Bye-bye.